Daddy's Girl, read by Deborah Watling. Daughter of Jack has been used so often in the press whenever I am discussed. I don't mind one bit, because my father was a great actor of stage and screen. During his career, he made more than 50 movies, including timeless war classics such as We Dive at Dawn, The Way Ahead, Sink the Bismarck. The list is endless. But he didn't actually envisage becoming an actor. These days, nearly everyone wants to be famous for something. But Dad was born in Walthamstow and raised in Chingford, and only developed theatrical aspirations after a trip to Stratford to see a Shakespearean production. He'd previously seen Laurence Olivier play Hamlet at London's Old Vic, and had been more impressed by the buskers outside, but now suddenly felt a calling to the acting world. He failed to Secretarial College and trained at the prestigious Italia Conti School of Acting, making his West End debut in Once a Crook in 1939. He actually told a white lie to Equity to gain membership, adding to his age, so he could get on with his career. His breakthrough came with a part in the Terence Rattigan's play Flarepath, a play I myself appeared in many years later. With the country at war, Father wanted to do his bit and enrolled in the RAF, training as a navigator. Although he trained successfully, he was let down by his eyesight and couldn't take up the position. In the end, he was posted to the film unit with Richard Attenborough, making films to help morale during the war. My mother, Patricia Hicks, was a film actress with experience of the stage both on Broadway and in the West End. She married before the war, but sadly her husband was killed in an accident, leaving her widowed with a daughter, Dillis. Dillis is in fact my half-sister. Daddy adopted her, but I had never thought of her as a stepsister. She's my big sister. It wasn't long after the war that Mother and Father met, as they were both acting in different plays in London at the time. It was George Cole who spotted her first, rather excitedly saying to Father, "You've got to come and see this bit of crumpet in the park." Mother was playing Hermia in an open-air production of A Midsummer Night's Dream at Regent's Park, whilst Daddy was in The Winslow Boy at the Lyric Theatre. He was the debonair young matinee idol and set about wooing my mother immediately. He succeeded, despite the attempts of one unscrupulous friend who told Mummy not to bother with him because he's gay. Father happily disproved this when he gave her a lift home one evening, staged a breakdown in Epping Forest, and pounced. Family legend goes that I was conceived in the number 2 dressing room, proof, if any were needed, that my origins are firmly theatrical. I was already on my way when Mummy and Daddy got married in the summer of 1947, which meant that they actually had to tell people that I was premature when I made my debut in January the following year. Such was the stigma attached to sex before marriage. They even had to pretend to their families. I was born in Queen Charlotte's Hospital in London, which was a very grand place. Everybody wanted to have their baby there in those days. Mother found it somewhat grim, however, and said that the nurses, they were so strict and foreboding that she didn't want to speak to them at all. I just sort of popped out whilst they weren't around. Father always maintained that Mother was better at acting than he was, and joked at how he thought that, once he married her, he'd be able to retire and live off her roles. Mummy shattered this illusion early on by confidently stating, "Here's my daughter, here's my mother, we're all moving, and I'm going to quit the business." She didn't straight away, but did not long before I was born. She was appearing on Broadway in arsenic and old lace, and started to get pernicious sickness. She couldn't even hold down water, and the stage started to spin around her. As a seasoned professional, she made it through the run, but decided enough was enough when she got home, and that it was going to be it for her. We lived in Epping at Kendall Avenue in a house called The Oaks. There was Nanny and Grandad, my mother's parents, father, mother, myself, and Dearest. We had various lodgers too, who would come and stop for a while to supplement the income and help pay the mortgage. Father was always travelling back and forth into London to play in the West End, and Mother would often accompany him, so Nanny took charge of a great deal of day-to-day things and bringing up his children. Nanny was a great organiser. She was also always there for us. Not that Mother and Father weren't. Father's career was thriving, and Mother was usually on hand to offer support whilst he was away on tour or filming. So Nanny was a very solid constant in my life. Nanny was a wonderful, quirky character. The girls at school used to come and love having tea because they like Mum's salad with vinaigrette dressing. And so we had somebody around nearly every day. One day, Nanny exclaimed, "Why don't you go to your own houses? Why do you come here? Why don't you take Debs around to your homes?" "How dare you say that to my friends?" I stormed. "They're costing us a fortune," she fumed. "Why do you come here?" "We like the house, and we like being here, and we like you," they replied. "All right," she said, melting instantly. On one occasion, Father was appearing in the West End, and he decided to take the family and the cast of the show to the Savoy Grill for dinner after opening night to celebrate. Nanny always wore her hat everywhere, and she also loved wearing her big fur coat. The Savoy was, as it still is, a very pricey place to dine. "Look at the price of this, Jack," she exclaimed. "It's daylight robbery." Nanny organised the waiters as if she was the manager, clicking her fingers and having them run around back and forth. They had a brilliant service and an excellent meal, but Nanny still wasn't impressed. She kept saying how expensive it all was and how they couldn't possibly justify the price. They finished the meal and were walking down the Strand when Father noticed Nanny was looking a bit plumper than she had done earlier. "What's wrong with your coat?" he asked. Nanny proudly peeled back the flaps of her coat to unveil a shining silver canteen of cutlery, which she'd pilfered from the Savoy. Mummy and Daddy were aghast. "You haven't just stolen that," said Mother, horrified. "The prices they charge, they should expect it," Nanny replied, unabashed. Nanny was the queen of Andram in Epping, but could be rather embarrassing in how she pushed you forward sometimes. She belonged to the Women's Institute, and every year they would have an evening where you took your grandchildren along. They would perform a song or recite a poem. The ladies would clap and coo. It would be all very nice, and everyone would be very proud. One year, Nanny took me along to this event. "Go on, Debbie. Go up and do a song for us," she said, ushering me onto the stage. I stood up on the stage and thought for a moment, what could I sing? I was about five or so, and I suddenly remembered a song Dillis taught me. I looked out at the aging crowd with their hats and blue rinses, then took a deep breath and launched into my little tune. Old Mrs. Pelly with a bamboo belly and her tits tied up with string, sitting on the grass with her finger up her ass, singing God Save the Queen. The jaws on the faces of the pensionable crowd dropped in horror and sheer disbelief. Nanny nearly fainted. But it wasn't my fault. No, Dillis taught it to me. I didn't realise it was rude.